Hello, my dear adventurers. It's Fox, and welcome to our cozy haven of stories and dreams. Leave your worries behind tonight as we venture into the heart of ancient Ireland, exploring tales of magic, mystery, and the beguiling fae. There was a king in the ancient Irish forests whose name was Colwyth O'Hara, and he had three daughters. One time when the king was away from home, the eldest daughter had a thought that she'd like to be married. So she went up in the castle, put on the cloak of darkness which her father had, and wished for the most beautiful man under the sun as a husband for herself. She got her wish, for scarcely had she put off the cloak when there came, in a golden coach with four horses, two black and two white, the finest man she had ever laid eyes on, and took her away. When the second daughter saw what had happened to her sister, she put on the cloak of darkness and wished for the next best man in the world as a husband. She put off the cloak, and straightway there came, in a golden coach with four black horses, a man nearly as good as the first, and took her away. The third sister put on the cloak and wished for the best white dog in the world. Presently he came, with one man attending, in a golden coach and four snow-white horses, and took the youngest sister away. When the king came home, the stable boy told him what had happened while he was gone. He was enraged beyond measure when he heard that his youngest daughter had wished for a white dog and gone off with him. When the first man brought his wife home, he asked, "In what form will you have me in the daytime? As I am now in the daytime, or as I am now at night?" "As you are now in the daytime," she replied. So the first sister had her husband as a man in the daytime, but at night he was a seal. The second man put the same question to the middle sister and got the same answer. So the second sister had her husband in the same form as the first. When the third sister came to where the white dog lived, he asked her, "How will you have me to be in the daytime? As I am now in the day, or as I am now at night?" "As you are now in the day," she said, to his surprise. So the youngest sister's husband was a dog in the daytime, but the most beautiful of men at night. After a time, the third sister had a son, and one day, when her husband was going out to hunt, he warned her that if anything should happen, the child, not to shed a tear on that account. While he was gone, a great grey crow that used to haunt the place came and carried the child away when it was a week old. Remembering the warning, she shed not a tear for the loss. All went on as before, till another son was born. The husband used to go hunting every day, and again he said she must not shed a tear if anything happened. When the child was a week old, a great grey crow came and bore him away, but the mother did not cry or drop a tear. All went well till a daughter was born. When she was a week old, the crow came and swept her away. This time, the mother dropped one tear on a handkerchief, which she took out of her pocket and then put back again. When the husband came home from hunting and heard what the crow had done, he asked the wife, "Have you shed tears this time?" "I have shed just one," said she. Then he was very angry, for he knew what harm she had done by dropping that one tear. Soon after, their father invited the three sisters to visit him and be present at a great feast in their honor. They sent messages, each from her own place, that they would come. The king was very glad at the prospect of seeing his children, but the queen was grieved and thought it a great disgrace that her youngest daughter had no one to come home with her but a white dog. The white dog was worried that the king wouldn't leave him inside with the company, but would drive him from the castle to the yard, and that the dogs outside wouldn't leave a patch of skin on his back, and would tear the life out of him. The youngest daughter comforted him. "There is no danger to you," she whispered, "for wherever I am, you'll be, and wherever you go, I'll follow and take care of you." When all was ready for the feast at the castle and the company were assembled, the king attempted to banish the white dog. But the youngest daughter would not listen to her father, would not let the white dog out of her sight, but kept him near her at the feast and divided with him the food that came to herself. When the feast was over and all the guests had gone, the three sisters went to their own rooms in the castle. Late in the evening, the queen took the cook with her and stole in to see what was in her daughter's rooms. They were all asleep at the time, and she saw by the side of her youngest daughter the most beautiful man she had ever laid eyes on. Then she went to where the other two daughters were sleeping, and there, instead of the two men who brought them to the feast, were two seals, fast asleep and loudly snoring. The queen was greatly troubled at the sight of the seals. When she and the cook were returning, they came upon the shed skin of the white dog. She caught it up as she went and threw it into the kitchen fire. The skin was not 5 minutes in the fire when it gave a crack that woke not only all in the castle, but all in the country for miles around. The husband of the youngest daughter sprang up. He was very angry and very sorry, and said, "If I had been able to spend 3 nights with you under your father's roof, I should have got back my own form again for good, and could have been a man both in the day and the night. But now I must go." He rose from the bed, ran out of the castle, and away he went, as fast as ever his two legs could carry him. He was this way all that night and the next day. But he couldn't leave the wife, for she followed from the castle, was after him in the night and the day too, and never lost sight of him. In the afternoon he turned and told her to go back to her father, but she would not listen to him. At nightfall, they came to the first house they had seen since leaving the castle. He said, "Go inside and stay in this house till morning. I'll pass the night outside where I am." The wife went in, and the woman of the house rose up, gave her a pleasant welcome, and put a good supper before her. She was not long in the house when a little boy came to her knee and called her mother. The woman of the house told the child to go back to his place and not to come out again. "Here are a pair of scissors," said the woman of the house to the king's daughter, "and they will serve you well. Whatever ragged people you see, if you cut a piece off their rags, that moment they will have new clothes of cloth of gold." She stayed that night, for she had good welcome. Next morning, when she went out, her husband said, "You'd better go home now to your father." "I'll not go to my father if I have to leave you," said she. So he went on, and she followed. It was that way all the day till night came. And at nightfall, they saw another house at the foot of a hill. And again, the husband stopped and said, "You go in. I'll sleep outside till morning." The woman of the house gave her a good welcome. After she had eaten and drunk, a little boy came out of another room, ran to her knee, and said, "Mother." The woman of the house sent the boy back to where he had come from and told him to stay there. Next morning, when the princess was going out to her husband, the woman gave her a comb and said, "If you meet any person with a diseased and a sore head, and draw this comb over it 3 times, the head will be well and covered with the most beautiful golden hair ever seen." She took the comb and went out to her husband. "Leave me now," said he, "and go back to your own father." "I will not," said she, "but I will follow you while I have the power." So they went forward that day, as on the other two. At nightfall, they came to a third house at the foot of a hill, where the princess received a good welcome. After she had eaten supper, a little girl with only one eye came to her knee and said, "Mother." The princess began to cry at sight of the child, thinking that she herself was the cause that it had but one eye. Then she put her hand into her pocket, where she kept the handkerchief on which she had dropped the tear when the grey crow carried her infant away. She had never used the handkerchief since that day, for there was an eye on it. She opened the handkerchief and put the eye in the girl's head. It grew into the socket that minute, and the child saw out of it as well as out of the other eye. And then the woman of the house sent the little one to bed. Next morning, as the king's daughter was going out, the woman of the house gave her a whistle and said, "Whenever you put this whistle to your mouth and blow on it, all the birds of the air will come to you from every quarter under the sun. Be careful of the whistle, as it may serve you greatly. Go back to your father's castle," said the husband when she came to him, "for I must leave you today." They went on together a few hundred yards, and then sat on a green hillock. And he told the wife, "Your mother has come between us. But for her, we might have lived together all our days. If I had been allowed to pass 3 nights with you in your father's house, I should have got back my form of a man, both in the daytime and the night." The queen of Tir Nanog, the land of youth, enchanted and put on me a spell that unless I could spend 3 nights with a wife under her father's roof, I should bear the form of a white dog, one half of my time. But if the skin of the dog should be burned before the 3 nights were over, I must go down to her kingdom and marry the queen herself. And 'tis to her I am going today. I have no power to stay, and I must leave you. So farewell. You'll never see me again on the upper earth." He left her sitting on the mound, went a few steps forward to some bulrushes, pulled up one and disappeared in the opening where the rush had been. She stopped there, sitting on the mound, lamenting till evening, not knowing what to do. At last she bethought herself, and going to the rushes, pulled up a stalk, went down, followed her husband, and never stopped till she came to the lower land. After a while she reached a small house near a splendid castle. She went into the house and asked, could she stay there till morning? "You can," said the woman of the house, "and welcome." Next day, the woman of the house was washing clothes, for that was how she made a living. The princess fell to and helped her with the work. In the course of that day, the queen of Tir Nanog and the husband of the princess were married. Near the castle, and not far from the washerwoman's, lived a henwife with 2 ragged little daughters. One of them came around the washerwoman's house to play. The child looked so poor, and her clothes were so torn and dirty, that the princess took pity on her and cut the clothes with the scissors which she had. That moment, the most beautiful dress of cloth of gold ever seen on woman or child in that kingdom was on the henwife's daughter. When she saw what she had on, the child ran home to her mother as fast as ever she could go. "Who gave you that dress?" asked the henwife. "A strange woman that is in that house beyond," said the little girl, pointing to the washerwoman's house. The henwife went straight to the queen of Tir Nanog and said, "There is a strange woman in the place who will be likely to take your husband from you unless you banish her away or do something to her. For she has a pair of scissors different from anything ever seen or heard of in this country." When the queen heard this, she sent word to the princess that, unless the scissors were given up to her without delay, she would have the head off her. The princess said she would give up the scissors if the queen would let her pass 1 night with her husband. The queen answered that she was willing to give her the 1 night. The princess came and gave up the scissors and went to her own husband. But the queen had given him a drink, and he fell asleep and never woke till after the princess had gone in the morning. Next day, another daughter of the henwife went to the washerwoman's house to play. She was wretched looking, her head being covered with scabs and sores. The princess drew the comb 3 times over the child's head, cured it, and covered it with beautiful golden hair. The little girl ran home and told her mother how the strange woman had drawn the comb over her head, cured it, and given her beautiful golden hair. The henwife hurried off to the queen and said, "That strange woman has a comb with wonderful power to cure and give golden hair, and she'll take your husband from you unless you banish her or take her life." The queen sent word to the princess that unless she gave up the comb, she would have her life. The princess returned as answer that she would give up the comb if she might pass one night with the queen's husband. The queen was willing and gave her husband a draught as before. When the princess came, he was fast asleep and did not waken till after she had gone in the morning. On the 3rd day, the washerwoman and the princess went out to walk, and the first daughter of the henwife with them. When they were outside the town, the princess put the whistle to her mouth and blew. That moment, the birds of the air flew to her from every direction in flocks. Among them was a bird of song and new tales. The princess went to one side with the bird. "What means can I take?" asked she. "Against the queen to get back my husband. Is it best to kill her, and can I do it?" "It is very hard," said the bird, "to kill her. There is no one in all Tir na n'Og who is able to take her life but her own husband. Inside a holly tree in front of the castle is a ram, in the ram a duck, in the duck an egg, and in that egg is her heart and life. No man can cut that holly tree but her husband." The princess blew the whistle again. A fox and a hawk came to her. She caught and put them into 2 boxes, which the washerwoman had with her, and took them to her new home. When the henwife's daughter went home, she told her mother about the whistle. Away ran the henwife to the queen and said, "That strange woman has a whistle that brings together all the birds of the air, and she'll have your husband yet unless you take her head." "I'll take the whistle from her anyhow," said the queen. So she sent for the whistle. The princess gave answer that she would give up the whistle if she might pass one night with the queen's husband. The queen agreed and gave him a draught as on the other nights. He was asleep when the princess came and when she went away. Before going, the princess left a letter with his servant for the queen's husband, in which she told how she had followed him to Tir na n'Og and had given the scissors, the comb, and the whistle to pass 3 nights in his company, but had not spoken to him because the queen had given him sleeping draughts, that the life of the queen was in an egg, the egg in a duck, the duck in a ram, the ram in a holly tree in front of the castle, and that no man could split the tree but himself. As soon as he got the letter, the husband took an axe and went to the holly tree. When he came to the tree, he found the princess there before him, having the two boxes with the fox and the hawk in them. He struck the tree a few blows. It split open, and out sprang the ram. He ran scarce 20 perches before the fox caught him. The fox tore him open, then the duck flew out. The duck had not flown 15 perches when the hawk caught and killed her, smashing the egg. That instant, the queen of Tir nan og died. The husband kissed and embraced his faithful wife. He gave a great feast, and when the feast was over, he burned the henwife with her house, built a palace for the washerwoman, and made his servant secretary. They never left Tir nan og and are living there happily now, and so may we live here. In the heart of Ireland, where the mists weave through the hills like a dance of spirits, there lay a village untouched by time. This village had a secret, a pact made long ago with the Fae, the mysterious and capricious beings of the Otherworld, a realm parallel to our own, veiled in enchantment and shadow. This ancient pact decreed the promise that the Fae would protect the villagers from misfortune. In return, they were to abide by one rule: never to venture into the forbidden forest that lay at the edge of the village, shrouded in perpetual twilight after dusk. The agreement had held for generations, passed down through the ages like a sacred torch, its origins lost to the mists of time, and the villagers lived in harmony with the land and its unseen guardians. But as the years turned, the seeds of curiosity and the innate restlessness of human nature began to stir within the hearts of the villagers. Whispers of the wonders and dangers of the forbidden forest grew into tales of enchantment and temptation. The forest called to them, a siren song of the unknown, promising secrets and adventures beyond their wildest dreams. A young villager named Eamon, with hair as dark as the raven and eyes filled with the spark of curiosity, found himself drawn to the forbidden forest. He had heard the tales of the Fae, of their beauty and their wrath, and something deep within him yearned to uncover the truth. One evening, under the cloak of twilight, Eamon ventured into the forest. The trees whispered secrets in a language lost to men, and the deeper he walked, the more the line between the worlds seemed to blur. After hours of wandering, he began to wonder if perhaps he should turn back. Having found nothing of the Fae and the ancient oaths but a beguiling sense of awe and unease, it was then that he saw her. A Fae maiden, bathing in a moonlit glade, her skin glowing with fairy light, her presence commanding yet ethereal, like a vision crafted from moonlight and shadow. The moment she sensed Eamon's approach, she turned towards him, her movements graceful, her eyes, shimmering pools of the deepest green, reflected a world unseen by mortal eyes, capturing the very essence of the other world. An enigmatic smile played upon her lips, and in that smile, Aemon sensed a blend of curiosity and amusement. As if she found his bewilderment both expected and delightfully intriguing. She introduced herself in a voice that carried the melody of the forest. "I am Aisling," she said, her words a gentle echo in the still air. "Guardian of these woods and daughter to the Fae King." As days turned into weeks, Aemon found himself returning to the glade to meet Aisling in secret. Breaking the ancient pact with every nightfall, drawn by an inexplicable bond that seemed to grow stronger with every encounter. Aisling, too, found herself intrigued by this human's genuine wonder and respect for the natural world. Traits seldom seen in those from beyond the Fae realm. Their conversations, once cautious, flourished into exchanges of tales and laughter, of human dreams and Fae magic. They shared stories under the moonlit sky, Aisling teaching Aemon about the ancient magics of the Otherworld that wove through the fabric of the forest, of battles fought and alliances forged, of magic that could bend the very fabric of reality. Aemon, in turn, spoke about the human world, its joys and sorrows, its fleeting nature, and the dreams that propelled it forward. He described the beauty of the mundane, seen through eyes unaccustomed to the wonders of the Fae, providing Aisling a glimpse into a life governed by time and change. And yet, with each visit, a sense of unease began to grow within him. The forest seemed darker, the mists thicker, and whispers of discontent stirred among the trees. The villagers noticed the change as well. Crops began to fail, livestock grew ill, and an unspoken fear settled over the village. The elders spoke in hushed tones of the broken pact and the wrath of the Fae. One night, as Aemon made his way to the glade, he found Aisling waiting for him with a solemn expression. She revealed the truth that she had kept hidden. With every visit, the barrier between the worlds weakened, and dark entities from the other world sought to break through, drawn by Aemon's human energy. The twist of fate was cruel. Aemon's love for Aisling and his desire to uncover the mysteries of the Fae had endangered his own village. The only way to mend the rift and protect both worlds was for Aemon to forget Aisling and the Fae, to never venture into the forest again. A powerful spell would seal his memories and the breach, but at a great cost. The love they shared would be sacrificed, and Aisling would return to the other world, never to meet Aemon again. With a heavy heart, Aemon agreed. As Aisling whispered the spell, Aemon's memories of her and the Fae began to fade, like mist under the morning sun. He found himself standing at the edge of the forest, the urge to explore gone, a vague sense of loss his only companion. The village slowly recovered, the crops flourished once more, and peace was restored. Aemon, with no recollection of the events, continued his life, occasionally pausing at the forest's edge with an unexplainable ache in his heart. The pact between the villagers and the Fae was mended, but the forbidden forest remained. A reminder of the delicate balance between curiosity and caution, the seen and the unseen, the human heart and the mysteries of the Fae. Long ago, in the lush green valleys of ancient Ireland, there reigned a mighty king named Lir. He was known far and wide for his wisdom, generosity, and fair rule. King Lir was blessed with a wife named Aoib, whose beauty was renowned throughout the land. Together, they had four children, Fionnuala, Aod, Fiacra, and Conn. Their laughter echoed through the halls of the royal palace, filling their parents' hearts with joy. But happiness, as fleeting as the morning mist, soon turned to sorrow. Tragedy struck when Oib, beloved wife and mother, fell gravely ill and passed away. King Lir was overcome with grief, and the kingdom mourned alongside him. In time, however, the king's advisors urged him to remarry, believing it would bring stability and happiness back to the realm. Reluctantly, King Lir agreed, hoping for a motherly figure to care for his motherless children. Aoife, a woman of great beauty, but with a heart tainted by envy and ambition, became the new queen. From the moment she entered the palace, a darkness seemed to settle upon its walls. Jealousy gnawed at her heart as she witnessed the love between King Lir and his children. A love that reminded her of what she herself lacked. As the days passed, Aoife's resentment grew, twisting her thoughts into dark and treacherous paths. Consumed by jealousy, she sought to rid herself of the king's children, seeing them as obstacles to her own ambitions. One fateful day, she took the children to a secluded lake, promising them a day of adventure and play. But her intentions were far from innocent. With whispered incantations and malevolent magic, she cast a powerful spell upon them, transforming them into swans of exquisite beauty. The children, bewildered and frightened, found themselves trapped in avian forms, their human bodies replaced by sleek feathers and graceful wings. Despite their newfound plight, they remained bound by their love for each other and their father. For 900 years, they glided upon the shimmering waters of Lough Derávarag, their wings catching the golden light of dawn and dusk. They faced storms and tempests, hunters and predators, yet their spirits remained unbroken. As the centuries passed, their longing for their father grew stronger, their hearts aching for the warmth of his embrace. Meanwhile, King Lir, unaware of their fate, searched the length and breadth of the kingdom for his lost children, his grief unyielding. Their tale of sorrow and endurance spread throughout the land, carried by the whispered winds and murmuring streams. It became a story of love tested by adversity, of innocence betrayed by envy. Finally, after 9 centuries had passed, the swans heard whispers of a prophecy. A prophecy that spoke of a Christian monk whose blessing could break the spell that bound them. With renewed hope in their hearts, they set out across the vast expanse of the Sea of Moyle, guided by the distant shores of the Isle of Glora. At long last, they reached the tranquil shores, where a humble monastery stood bathed in the golden light of dawn. There, they found the monk, a gentle soul whose eyes shone with kindness and compassion. With words of blessing and prayers of salvation, the monk broke the enchantment that held them captive. As the first light of dawn touched their feathers, the swans felt a warmth spreading through their bodies, a sensation long forgotten. Their avian forms melted away, revealing their true selves once more. But time had taken its toll, and they emerged as old and weary as the ancient oaks that shaded the monastery grounds. With tears of joy and sadness mingling on their cheeks, they embraced each other one last time, their hearts heavy with the weight of 9 centuries worth of memories. And as the sun rose high in the sky, casting its golden glow upon the world below, they closed their eyes and surrendered to the eternal embrace of sleep. Their spirits, freed from the confines of mortal flesh, ascended to the heavens, where they were reunited with their beloved mother. Together, they soared among the stars, their voices blending with the celestial chorus in a song of everlasting peace and love. And so, the tale of the Children of Lir passed into legend, a testament to the enduring power of love, the destructive force of jealousy, and the resilience of the human spirit in the face of adversity. As we close this chapter on the charming world of Irish folk tales and the beguiling fae, let their mysterious magic stay with you. Allow their stories to gently guide your dreams tonight. Rest well, and may you wake with a touch of enchantment in your heart.